then you're going to see a rim run. The first big guy down runs right underneath the rim. That puts a ton of pressure on your transition defense to get back, and it also flattens out your defense. And then the second big, the trail big, is really dangerous, not just for a reversal, but you get the ball inside. Isaiah Hicks dives to the rim, gets an easy basket. North Carolina's primary break sets up their secondary break, and their secondary break can be devastating in large part because their primary break is so good.
A Hall of Famer for each team. Roy Williams for the Tar Heels, Mike Krzyzewski for the Blue Devils. They've had so many good games. Of course, Coach Williams back as the head coach of Carolina for 14 years. Mike Krzyzewski in his 37th year as the head coach at Duke. Brian Dorsey, Bill Covington, Ron Gruber, our officials. Carolina, by virtue of being the higher seed, they will wear the home jerseys, and we're underway here in Brooklyn.
Matt Jones guarding Joel Berry, the guy that went for 28 in the last meeting. Now he just switched off onto Justin Jackson. You can see a lot of switching in this game.
Tatum switches on to Pinson. Jackson into Hicks, double team immediately. He tries to fight his way through it, but he stepped out of bounds. No, or was there a foul? There is a foul on Duke.
Those double teams have got to be tight because Isaiah Hicks looking to be aggressive through them. Instead of just dribbling out and passing, he's trying to score.
2 points that should be made early. Carolina is a deeper team than Duke, and Carolina's playing for the second time in as many nights. Duke is playing for the third time in as many nights as Meeks gets the Tar Heels on the board.
Right away, North Carolina looking to go inside, and anytime Jason Tatum is guarding a big guy, that's a matchup that North Carolina can and should go after.
Each team really trying to exploit the advantage they have at the Tatum spot, whether Tatum can take a big guy outside and whether he can guard a big guy inside.
Well, that's the matchup advantage for Duke. A terrific pass, not enough pressure on the ball by Matt Jones to discourage that pass. That was just a straight line pass. And anytime you get caught behind, which Jason Tatum did, that's going to be an easy 2 points.
Matt Jones with the ball for Duke, really struggling to shoot the ball his last 6 games. He's been on the bench a little bit more. Grayson Allen was a big factor off the bench in the quarterfinal win for Duke yesterday over Louisville.
Theo Pinson guarding Luke Kennard.
Kennard the handoff, Jackson the kick, or rather Jones the kick out to Jackson, who will miss the jumper, and Berry, a very good rebounding guard, down with it for Carolina.
Really good cold closeout by Joel Berry to make Frank Jackson go for two instead of three.
And Berry drives at the length of the court and draws the foul. Jason Tatum whistled for the foul.
And there's North Carolina's primary break. Joel Berry pushing the ball and getting it all the way into the paint. North Carolina scores a ton of points in the paint, but it's not all their big guys getting post position. It's taking the ball to the basket, especially in transition.
Joel Berry, second team All-ACC this year, had a terrific season, 15 points per game, at 83% shooter from the line. I think it was Coach Greenberg who said yesterday, I mean, Justin Jackson, ACC Player of the Year, had a sensational year, but Seth Greenberg describes Berry as the heartbeat of this North Carolina team.
Well, he was the one that won their game at Clemson when North Carolina struggled. He had 31 points in that game, North Carolina winning that game on the road in overtime. Struggled a little bit against Miami, but because the rest of his team was so good and because his defense was so good, North Carolina just dominated the game.
Jackson with a step in, too strong off the glass. Ball still loose and finally comes down to Hicks.
Another good closeout by Berry, forcing a two instead of a three.
Deflected away, and Duke controls. Tatum, who's got 45 points in Duke's first 2 games here for the ACC tournament. One-on-one with Hicks. Step back jumper, got it.
Wow. Well, he's not been shooting the ball well from three of late, but anything mid-range, he can fall away, gets his shot off, he can create his own. That's a matchup against the North Carolina big guy that Duke is going to go to over and over again.
Look inside for Meeks. Jefferson's already got one foul. Meeks kind of throws up a prayer, and it goes in to make it 6-2.
It might have looked like a prayer, but North Carolina practices those jump hooks over their weak shoulder. They're going to go turnaround jumper over their strong shoulder depending on where the defense is playing them. They've always got a counter to how they're being played.
Kennard off the back of the iron, and Hicks down with a rebound. Pinson rejected. Jefferson coming over to help.
So far, Duke has done a very good job on Justin Jackson. He has not been able to get an open look.
Hicks has it taken away by Tatum, and the Blue Devils come down in transition. Tatum, end-to-end. He's got both buckets for Duke.
What a play. Isaiah Hicks tried to spin on Jason Tatum, took the ball away and turned it into 2 points.
And Carolina going inside at every opportunity. Jackson finds Meeks.
Well, North Carolina isolating Kennedy Meeks down low. He was all by himself, and he was able to hold off an excellent defender, Nemeal Jefferson. Not enough pressure on the ball. When you don't have pressure on the ball, you can see in.
Meeks 3 for 3, 6 points in the early going for the Tar Heels.
And they've been easy baskets. You have to work hard for easy baskets.
And they're going in there again. They know where their bread is butter, don't they? Going inside time and time again, trying to take advantage of their size advantage on the inside. Meeks off to a great start. And Jackson, another assist for the Tar Heels.
And you can't expect Nemeal Jefferson to be able to hold position and, you know, take away an angle on every possession.
Kennard fouled on a 3-point attempt.
Duke has got to get better pressure on the ball to discourage those passes, because North Carolina able to see in, and they are picking Duke apart on the interior. It has been easy basket after easy basket. And in order to counter that, Duke's going to have to start hitting some threes.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by New York
North Carolina. So wherever the matchup advantage is, Duke is going to take advantage of whatever big guy is guarding Jason Tatum, and North Carolina is going to look to whatever big guy Jason Tatum is guarding.
Duke's going to try to play to their strength. Carolina up 6 so far. Meeks 4 for 4, 8 points already, as Kennard will go to the line for 3 free throws. Was fouled on a 3-point attempt just before we went into the timeout. Kennard, in both games in which Duke has played here this week, one against Clemson and one against Louisville, has had a relatively, by his standards, quiet first half, but then has really erupted in the second half.
His total body of work has been pretty good, in other words. Mm-hmm.
How much stock do you put into the fact that one team is playing for the second day in a row and the other is playing for the third, in terms of whether you have your legs?
It's not dispositive. It's not the entire thing. But absolutely, you are going to, in the second half, it's going to get into your legs a little bit more when you've played two games and your opponent's only played one. Absolutely.
Hicks guarded by Tatum. Has to back it out. Pinson with a drive. Kennard knocks it away.
What an alert play by Luke Kennard.
Jefferson.
He was open right away.
Getting deep position and making it look easy over Meeks to bring Duke back within one.
This fabulous footwork by Nemeal Jefferson. Fakes one way and then went the other for the easy layup. But you get that deep position, it's over.
5 straight points for the Blue Devils. Jackson. Meeks battling hard for the offensive rebound. And we've got a foul going against Duke.
What a terrific job by Kennedy Meeks of keeping that ball alive. When the Carolina big guys cannot grab the ball, they keep it alive and give themselves another chance to grab it with both hands. That was great offensive rebounding by Kennedy Meeks.
Fouls on Matt Jones. Matt Jefferson is on Barry. We've got some mismatches. Barry will launch over him and miss the three.
North Carolina's taken some challenge shots.
Jefferson and Meeks again.
That was a great move by Nemeal Jefferson. Just didn't finish. And Matt Jones on Justin Jackson switched off.
Jackson with the floater. A little bit strong. Out of bounds to Duke. And our first subs of the night, Nate Britt, Luke May, will come into the game for North Carolina. Harry Giles, Grayson Allen into the game for Duke, and you can hear the Carolina fans getting on Allen.
Allen had a terrific game against Louisville. After having a goose egg against Clemson, didn't score in 12 minutes of playing time, had 18 points
and was really good against Louisville. Duke has had three guys really going offensively in each of their games so far here. It's been Tatum and Kennard in both. It was Jackson against Clemson and then Allen against Louisville. Big comeback by Duke. They were down 12 in the second half and came back to beat an excellent Louisville team by four.
Well, they went to the zone. That was a big factor.
Meeks with 10 already. He had 9 and 8 in the two regular season matchups against Duke. He's already got 10.
Single coverage, and North Carolina had really good action on the weak side. So Duke didn't come with the double. Single coverage is going to be advantage Kennedy Meeks. A good defense by Justin Jackson.
Some help there by Meeks. Shot clock at 12. Tatum a clear out with May. Rebound Britt.
Yeah, I don't think Jason Tatum would want to get all the way to the basket on Luke May. He settled for that jump shot. Of course, he can make it.
Barry drives and finishes.
Just a brilliant finisher, especially for his size. Joel Barry shoots the ball well, refuses the ball screen, takes it the other way. And both Luke May and Justin Jackson able to screen off Duke defenders so they can't get over to block the shot. And able to get a foul on Harry Giles, not because of his left hand, which he tried to block the shot with, but because of his right hand on the body of Joel Barry.
3-point play for Barry, 6-point lead, Carolina.
I wonder if Carolina's going to go with a trap at some point.
Tony Bradley has entered the game, Meeks to the bench. Britt knocks it out of the hands of Kennard, and it's out of bounds to Carolina.
Now, it looked like he knocked that ball away. Unless Kennard touched it last, it seems unlikely. But the referees were right there. They must have seen it.
Kennard argues the call. Mike Krzyzewski argues the call.
Yeah, he knocked it right out of his hands. How could that have been off of Luke Kennard? That's impossible. Given the benefit of the doubt, but
May will take a three. Bradley with the offensive rebound has it knocked away, but it stays at this end of the floor. Tony Bradley, the freshman, an outstanding offensive rebounder.
And goes after every offensive rebound with both hands. Grabbed that away from Harry Giles, and it looked like Tony Bradley got hit when he was going up.
First of two semifinals tonight here with the ACC tournament in Brooklyn. We've got Florida State and Notre Dame still to come tonight. The 2 seed against the 3 seed. May called for the moving screen.
That's a play that North Carolina runs out of bounds underneath where it looks like it's going to be a little back pick slice cut. It's really a screen in for Justin Jackson. And Luke May just moved to get more contact on the screen.
No true point guard for Duke. Allen, the closest thing they have on the floor right now. Jackson's on the bench. Kennard will handle the ball a lot as well as he drives. Lost it, tried to get it back. And we've got a tie-up, and the arrow will keep it with Duke as about half the players on the floor hit the deck.
That was a good defensive job there by Joel Barry. He was right there in front of the restricted arc on the drive. North Carolina has been very good defensively of late. They were excellent in the game against Miami. And it all started with Joel Barry and his pressure on the ball, pushing Miami further away from the basket to initiate their offense.
They held Miami to 53 points in their quarterfinal win, one going away, 78-53. Allen driving on Britt. Follow will go for Harry Giles.
And Bradley came over to block the shot that opened up the offensive glass for Duke and Harry Giles. Anytime there's a weak side shot blocker that comes over, if he doesn't block the shot, chances are you're going to give up an offensive board.
You talked about how much switching there is going on, and you weren't kidding. So many things are being switched, especially at this end of the floor. Nice entry feed from May to Bradley.
Well, with all the switching, that means there are going to be matchups and communication issues, especially when you've got a freshman on the floor that hasn't played a lot of minutes like Harry Giles. So there are some risks associated with switching.
All 7 field goals for the Tar Heels have come in the paint. Now a steal by Jackson.
Well, that was a foul, too.
Yeah, Jackson thought so. He'll get the bucket, not the call, but the lead grows to 8.
And maybe that's the kind of thing that can get Justin Jackson going. He's taken some tough shots in this game. But oftentimes when you can get something easy, like a transition layup, you see the ball go through the basket, helps the score.
Tatum off the glass. But they better get back. Here come the heels. Barry in a heartbeat from one end of the court to the other.
That is where North Carolina is most dangerous. Duke gets a layup, gives up a layup in no time. That couldn't have been more than 3 seconds.
And Allen fouled on the drive. We've got a timeout on the floor.
Well, we talked about North Carolina's primary break before the game and spotlighted that. You lay it in on North Carolina. The first they're going to steal it. Justin Jackson takes it the other way. Could easily have been a three-point play. And Joel Berry, like a bullet down the other end after Duke scores to get the bucket back.
So lots of things going on around the country. Bubbles being burst, teams trying to solidify their bids. Here it's about getting to the ACC championship game between these two arch rivals, Duke and Carolina. First meeting back on February the 9th. Jason Tatum, 19, all in the second half. Luke Kennard knocking down one of Duke's 13 threes. Grayson Allen finished with a team-high 25. Duke wins 86-78. The rematch March the 4th, as in last Saturday in Chapel Hill. Isaiah Hicks had a big night on his senior night at the Dean Dome. Joel Berry knocked down all 5 of his threes at a game-high 28. Carolina beats Duke 90-83. The best thing about this rivalry is how even it has been, how every single year, it seems, both teams are so good. And in their last 98 meetings, this is crazy, they've each won 49, and Duke is up by 1 point heading into the game tonight. Carolina, though, most relevantly, is up by 8 points right now in this one.
In order for Duke to beat North Carolina, I believe the Blue Devils have to win the three-point battle. In the first game, they made 13 threes to North Carolina's 4. In the second matchup, North Carolina did a very good job from the three-point line. First of all, guarding it, but they also hit their threes.
Tap back out by Tatum and a fresh 30 for Duke. Tatum right now with a smaller defender and Pinson on him. Allen is open for a three and buries it.
He almost can't help off of Grayson Allen. He's going to hurt you from the three-point line. And Nate Britt helped off and then couldn't recover. Got a little screen from Jason Tatum, a little flare screen almost.
In your opinion, is there a faster team in America getting down the court on offense, even after a make? Than North Carolina
is. Oh, no. North Carolina's transition game is absolutely fabulous, and especially when they get a quick outlet. And Duke looked like they went to a 2-3 zone on that last possession. And that's exactly what they're in.
Really helped them against Louisville, right? Foul against Luke May.
Yeah, I think the 2-3 zone against Louisville changed the game because Duke gave up 46 points in the paint to Louisville. And the Cardinals were getting to the bucket, getting into the lane, making plays. And that 2-3 zone really caused Louisville to stand around, to settle really for three-point shots and for jump shots instead of being more of an attacking team. But North Carolina's got a much better zone offense, and they've got better shooters.
Boy, Tatum had a pretty good look from about 18 feet and airballed it. Still to come tonight for the 2017 New York Life ACC Tournament here in Brooklyn, the second semifinal, the 2-seed Florida State Seminoles had a terrific year. So many wins over ranked teams, and they'll take on a very determined Notre Dame Fighting Irish team. Notre Dame very impressive in their quarterfinal win over Virginia last night. The championship game, 9 o'clock tomorrow night right here on ESPN.
Right now, Duke in that 2-3 zone when they're on the defensive end. And you've got Nate Britt, Theo Pinson, and Seventh Woods, none of which are great shooters.
Hicks running the court, can't get a shot off after the second made three by Allen, stolen by Jones, turns it back over to Pinson, and Bradley will slam it home.
Boy, what a turnaround. Duke gets a steal, having the opportunity to take it the other way, and Theo Pinson makes a play that turns the momentum back North Carolina's way.
Pinson on Allen. Allen gets the switch, launches again, and he's got three threes already in this game. Britt open in the corner, and Carolina answers.
Both North Carolina and Duke fired up after they make a play. Nate Britt with a howl after he knocked down that corner three to answer the three off the ball screen by Grayson Allen. Grayson Allen hit seven threes in the first matchup between these two teams. Got the high ball screen. Theo Pinson guarding him. And just pulled right up on Tony Bradley and knocked that down, and immediately had a little something to say afterwards.
Everybody's fired up. Fired up in the stands, fired up on the court. Subs for both teams. Duke made one change. Carolina made three. Again, they are a deeper team. Duke will really only go seven deep with Allen and Giles coming off the bench. Meeks among those who have returned for Carolina. Kennedy Meeks is 5 for 5, 10 points already in this game.
Back to the 2-3 zone, Giles in the middle.
Hicks rattles it home from the baseline.
We're having both Hicks and Meeks in the game at the same time against a zone. Those two can operate, they can make shots in the middle, they can screen the zone, and now you've got the two better shooters, Joel Berry and Justin Jackson, back in the ballgame.
Kennard finds Jackson way long, and a foul going on Hicks. So Grayson Allen hot for Duke, but Carolina with a lead up 6, 7:40 to go in the first half here in Brooklyn.
The markets can be very unpredictable. New York Life, on the other hand, is as consistent as my free throw.
New York Life ACC tournament, round 3 between Duke and Carolina with the Tar Heels up by 6.
Well, at times there are going to be matchup problems in this game. Kennedy Meeks guarding Jason Tatum, but on the other end, in transition, that means that Jason Tatum is going to have to guard Kennedy Meeks when they get the ball down to the other end. And that early post position, when Jason Tatum's fronting, they go right over the top. And watch after this Duke basket how quickly North Carolina gets the ball down the court. The quick inbound play, and within 2 seconds, they get it to the other end. 2 seconds, and then within 3 seconds, all the way to the bucket. Just amazing.
Thanks to Joel Berry. Berry with 7 points so far. Meeks has 10. Grayson Allen leads Duke with 9. And those have come on 3 3-point field goals. Jefferson, the fifth-year senior at the line for Duke, missed so much of last season with a broken foot, was granted a medical redshirt, came back this year, and has battled the foot problem at times this year, unrelated injury within the foot. When he's been healthy, Allison, he's been really good.
And, Dan, because of that foot injury, he is the player they're most worried about with the 3 games in 3 days. Talked to Jeff Capel before the game, and he said they're really going to have to keep an eye on him and make sure they see how he's feeling, because the more he plays, the more pain he is in, but he looks good so far.
All right, Allison, thank you. Pinson spinning on Kennard, finds Meeks, who's got a dozen.
Great move by Theo Pinson. Theo Pinson's got 13 assists coming into this game in his last two. Could have 14, but one of his passes went in the basket.
That's right. He threw up an alley-oop, and it went in for a three. Jackson into some traffic.
That's how good of a passer he is. He didn't want to settle for a two off the pass. He decided to make it a three.
Look at how quickly they get down the court again, and it's a three for Justin Jackson.
That's just beautiful basketball. Passing ahead to the open man who's ready to shoot.
So much speed and offensive ability.
Well, Theo Pinson getting the ball into the middle. And with the easy pass to Kennedy Meeks, and the North Carolina with their sideline advance, getting it up the floor, and Justin Jackson with a wide open three. He hasn't found many wide open threes in the last few ball games. That one of the few, and he took advantage of it.
North Carolina has 10 assists on their 14 made field goals. Duke has 2 assists on 8 made field goals. That's been a story for Duke the last 5-6 games. A lot of attacking, a lot of isolation, not as much ball movement as Carolina has. Carolina is just moving the ball like crazy, and here's a travel called on Duke. still to come after our second semifinal, Florida State Notre Dame here tonight. How about this? A semifinal for the Pac-12 tournament in Las Vegas. It will be UCLA and Arizona tonight at 11:30 Eastern time from Vegas. We had the pleasure of doing one of those games, the one down in Tucson, one by the Bruins. Arizona won at Pauley. Joe Lunardi says whoever wins that game moves up to the two line and knocks Louisville down to a three as Jackson makes a difficult shot to extend the lead to a dozen.
Well, you had Isaiah Hicks posting on one end, Kennedy Meeks coming up to the high post to relieve pressure, and then Justin Jackson posting up Grayson Allen down low.
Allen kicks to the corner. Tatum is open and knocks down a three. You said if Duke's going to win this game, they have to win the three-point line.
And that's been when Duke's been at its best, not just hitting threes, but with Grayson Allen driving the ball and driving to pass rather than finish. Well, he's a good passer.
Jackson, no. Meeks with a rebound. Down with it, Tatum.
Well, he just went right over the top of Emile Jefferson with both hands and grabbed that ball.
There he's staying with Jackson, now Tatum. Jefferson doesn't look to try to take Meeks, instead the handoff, and Grayson Allen has three, number four.
He is coming off these handoffs looking to fire. And if the big guy guarding Emile Jefferson is not right up, that ball's going up. Or the three-point line, especially Grayson Allen, really keeping Duke in this.
Hinson lost it, got it back, and Kennedy Meeks is piling up the points. He's up to 14 right now, 7 for 8, and 14 points for the senior.
And North Carolina wearing the paint out.
And that's why Mike Krzyzewski just sent Marquise Bolden to the scorer's table, looking for a bigger body to try to contain Meeks.
A nice job by Justin Jackson not to go for Grayson Allen's fakes.
Jefferson draws the foul.
North Carolina on the offensive end. Watch Kennedy Meeks coming up to relieve pressure, and then Justin Jackson just takes Grayson Allen right down into the post. And he is so good with those runners and floaters. That is such a tough shot, but it's a shot that he practices, and it's just about a layup for him.
And Justin Jackson and Luke Kennard would have a pretty good game of horse.
Holy cow. As good of a shooter as Justin Jackson is, I think Luke Kennard is actually a better shooter.
The foul was on Joel Berry, his second. He's staying. Couple of subs for the Tar Heels, but Berry stays on the court.
Well, Berry's a junior. Just have to be smart, not pick up a third.
Six-point game. Jefferson will sit Bolden into the game. And with Meeks going to the bench, Bolden will draw Bradley.
Marquise Bolden, who's got great feet, athletic, big, but he's not played many minutes this season.
Hicks muscles his way by Tatum and scores.
I think Bolden got him. Not able to get over there and establish position shoulder to shoulder with Jason Tatum. Over pursued. And then just used that left arm and came across the arm of Isaiah Hicks as he slipped that ball screen. And if the defender guarding you is above you, you slip it, go to the basket. Otherwise, set the screen.
So, Jay, if you look at the three biggest players that Carolina has, Meeks, Hicks, and Bradley, they are 11 for 13. And 23 points, 11 for 30. They're just dominating inside.
Well, and that's what we talked about. What's going to dominate? It's going to be the interior strength of North Carolina or the perimeter game of Duke. And the perimeter game of Duke is keeping them in it, especially Grayson Allen's threes. But these baskets are easy buckets.
And Bolden, another foul. Hicks will shoot a couple. Under four to go in the first half, a spot in the championship game in the eighth.
First half, really locking him down. All right, guys, get you up to date on everything. What a night here in Barclays Center of the ACC semis, and action going all over the place.
All right, Reese, thank you. And you mentioned Michigan. They'll talk about that. What a run for the Wolverines after that terrifying incident a couple of days ago where the plane skidded off the end of the runway after they aborted the takeoff. High winds. They had to fly into Washington day of and wore their practice jerseys. And they, you can imagine to go from what happened on the runway and then to all of a sudden have to focus on basketball again, the fact that those kids could go out and win a couple of games and beat a really good team in Purdue today in overtime. What a couple of days for the Wolverines.
But beyond unsettling on their trip to Washington, D.C., but Michigan can shoot it, and they've really improved on the defensive end.
Grayson Allen has made four threes in this game, and Carolina is still up 11 as they go inside for Tatum, and it's going to be Carolina ball. That'll be a turnover.
Tried to isolate Jason Tatum down low, went over the top, and that was a good call. Went right off the hands of Jason Tatum, went out of bounds. You have to expect that North Carolina is going to continue to go inside. Matt Jones guarding Justin Jackson. Little box set.
26 of Carolina's 42 points have come in the paint.
Another switch. Now Grayson Allen guarding Isaiah Hicks.
Jackson driving on Tatum. Forced it up through traffic, and Jefferson the rebound.
Now that wasn't the shot. Once you get that switch and Grayson Allen is guarding Hicks, you have to go to Hicks, give him the paint touch.
Luke Kennard without a field goal so far for Duke. He's got three free throws, but that's all. A guy who averaged 20 points per game on the season. First team all ACC. We mentioned he's really gotten it going in the second half of both games so far here in Brooklyn. It hasn't gotten untracked early in this one either. And Meeks back into the game for Carolina as Jackson picks up his second foul. Well, Jackson will stay with 3:10 to go in the half.
And not a smart foul there by Justin Jackson, because Isaiah Hicks did a really good job of hedging out on that ball screen. Grayson Allen wasn't going anywhere.
So it looks like Roy Williams may sit Barry and Jackson for the last 3:10. We'll see if the Blue Devils can take advantage.
North Carolina's got a lot of depth. They play their bench a lot, so it's not unusual to have multiple subs in the game. Allen guarding Hicks again. Emile Jefferson trying to give help.
Brandon Robinson takes the feed from Meeks, thinks about it. Hicks deep in the corner. Shot clock down to 7. Hicks forces one up.
What a rebound.
Pinson gets it to go.
What an offensive rebound by Theo Pinson. North Carolina was hesitating to put up a perimeter jumper even when they were open.
Allen misses the three. Numbers for Carolina. Pinson to Hicks.
Well, if Roy Williams is rolling the dice, they just came up 7s.
How about 6 assists already for Theo Pinson?
That puts him at 19 assists in his last 3 games. He's still got another 22 minutes to go. Theo Pinson bringing the ball up the middle of the floor, and Duke in full retreat. Couldn't get back and get anything established. You just have to sprint back. You can't backpedal. You have to sprint back and make a stand. North Carolina's doing it every which way. They're scoring off their defense. After Duke scores, they're able to get the ball down court quickly. The points in the paint, and not just by the big guys, have been the dominant factor in this game. And North Carolina's going to hang over 50 on Duke in this first half.
Shooting 63% right now, the Tar Heels are 19 for 30.
Good job by Pinson to come back after Emile Jefferson made it difficult for Nate Britt to catch it.
We've got some mismatches after some switches. Right now, Jackson, a guard, is on Meeks. He'll kick it to Britt, who's got Tatum on him. Bounce pass inside to Hicks for another bucket.
When North Carolina drives it, they are looking to pass. When help comes over, if the rotation is not perfect, it is a layup. And the points in the paint, North Carolina dominating the paint.
And 15 assists on 20 baskets, to your point about them looking to pass. Outstanding ratio. Tatum fade away over Hicks.
Oh, that's an NBA move. Went right into the chest of Hicks and then faded away.
Here they come again. And rejected. It'll still be with Carolina.
You put the ball in the basket and North Carolina's trying to lay it in on the other end. You can't rest for 1 second. And that's where the depth of North Carolina can wear you down over the course of a ball game. Two-three zone.
Meeks in the middle of it. And the rebound down to Kennard. Duke tries to get it down into single digits as we move into the final minute of the first half.
Kennard needs to get something going. He's been a second half player. Not a good foul by Isaiah Hicks there. A cheap one.
His second.
Well, sometimes you just have to let him go. You can get a basket back. You cannot get a foul back. Especially when you're fouling an 87% free throw shooter.
So four different Tar Heels, each with two fouls right now. And Tatum at the line for Duke. Bradley in, and Hicks will sit down. Tatum with 20 points against Clemson in a second round game, 25 against Louisville in the quarterfinal, and already 14 here tonight for the freshman.
And this is a really big 47 seconds to end this first half. If Duke can get a stop and can get another score, all of a sudden this game is down below 10 points. As poorly as Duke has played and well as North Carolina's played.
Tatum with a rebound. He might take it all the way. He will, and it goes in, and a foul to boot.
And Duke can not only get a three-point play here, if they get another stop, they're going to get the ball back. You get another stop. This is two games in a row that North Carolina has not handled the end of half well at all. Against Miami and now against Duke. And with all the great work that North Carolina has done in the paint, it could be just a couple possession game going into halftime. And this game looks a lot different now than it did 60 seconds ago.
It's a 7-0 Tatum run right now to get Duke back within six. Meeks has to pick up the dribble, but they get it over.
There's a 5 or 6 second differential on the shot clock and the game clock, so Duke is going to get the ball back no matter what.
Pinson with a pull-up. Meeks has it.
Wow. For another offensive rebound, and Kennedy Meeks just went right over the top and snatched that ball away. So when I said Duke's going to get the ball back no matter what, it's going to be back, it'll be after free throws.
Kennedy Meeks has had a big first half, 14 points and 6 rebounds.
He's also coming up on 1,000 rebounds career.
Yep. He is at 970 with the 6 rebounds that he has tonight. I'm sorry, that was as of last night. He's at 977 right now with the 6 rebounds he has tonight.
Probably won't get there tonight, but
probably will get there before the end of the season. They've got time. They've got Tatum. No call. And that will end the first half. Carolina dominating in the paint. Mike Krzyzewski unhappy they didn't get a call there at the end of the half. And Roy Williams Tar Heels have a 7-point lead on the Blue Devils at halftime, with the winner moving on to the championship game tomorrow night here with the Barclays Center in Brooklyn.
That's a 7-point lead. North Carolina has to believe it should be a bigger lead. They did not handle the end of half well.
49-42, Carolina. 20 more minutes to come, but first time for the halftime show, along with Jay Will and Coach Greenberg. Here's Reese Davis.
Somehow, some way, it always lives up to billing, doesn't it? Now the halftime report from Barclays Center. Tremendous first half. North Carolina was so impressive for much of it, and as Billis mentioned, didn't really finish the half the way they'd hoped. Second time in a row we've seen that. However, a couple of their stars were on the bench. I know guys put up big numbers. Theo Pinson was terrific in the first half on both ends of the floor, half dozen assists. What did you think about the end of the half and the kind of momentum it gave Duke?
It kind of was deja vu from the Miami game. You've got to have Joel Berry on the floor for North Carolina to be successful. He defends the ball. He takes care of the ball. He makes everyone else better. But I'll tell you one thing. It's also pretty good to have Kennedy Meeks and Isaiah Hicks, because those two guys were dominating in transition, in the paint, and on the glass.
Yeah, those two guys combined for 25 points. I think they had close to 10 rebounds. And look, Kennedy Meeks is a different player.
Show Carolina went to its strength, getting the ball inside.
They got the ball inside and dominated the paint. North Carolina was plus 22 in the paint. They did it in different ways. They were able to get the ball inside off of the high pick and roll. They come off, you get a hard roll to the basket, then you swing it to the right, and immediately the roll man is hit for an easy basket underneath. And even when Duke scored, and a basket by Duke, North Carolina gets the ball in quickly. 2 seconds to cross half court in the hands of Joel Berry. 3 seconds to get the ball to the rim. And so you put it through the bucket, they get it. Then offensive rebounding. They didn't get a lot of second chance points, only three, but they got a lot of second opportunities and two-handed rebounds. Theo Pinson getting this second chance and putting it in. And for Duke, they've got 30 points from Jason Tatum and Grayson Allen. They were 10 of 17 from the field. The rest of the Blue Devils, 2 of 11. If it weren't for the free throw line, this margin would be even bigger.
So Carolina leading by 7. Let's hear how Roy Williams felt about the first half. He visited moments ago with Allison Williams.
Coach Williams, you told us before the game that you had to make your advantage the most important thing. 32 points at the paint. How would you say you did?
Well, we did okay into the last 3 or 4 minutes. We started shooting jump shots. And the other thing we talked about is we got to stop fouling. We're putting them on the free throw line way too much.
What has been the key to how efficient your offense was in that first half?
Well, we got some easy ones inside, but we need to keep moving because we stopped moving in there as well.
All right, bye. Thanks.
Underway here in the second half. The winner into the championship game tomorrow night against the winner of our next semifinal will bring you tonight, Florida State and Notre Dame.
North Carolina running a familiar set, a little slice cut screen for the screener to try to get the ball to Justin Jackson. And Jackson aggressive to drive the ball.
What does Duke need to do in order to get Luke Kennard going? 5 points in the first half, but they all came to the free throw line as Meeks scores again. You got to figure for Duke to win the game, Kennard's got to have a big second half.
Well, Kennard's got to have a big second half, and Duke has to stop taking the ball out of the net. They've got to get some stops.
Kennard from the foul line, and it didn't take long for his first field goal of the night. Just 35 seconds into the second half.
Looks like we've got a contact lens issue.
And whatever it was, feels like Hicks has sorted it out and he'll stay. You can see that Duke trailed. Louisville came back, beat him with a big second half. Kennard had big second halves against both Clemson and Louisville already in this tournament. Justin Jackson. Yes!
Coming off 2 baseline screens, Justin Jackson caught that. Ready to shoot it. Didn't have a defender up on him.
Jackson's second three of the night. Tatum too strong from the corner, and Meeks another rebound.
And a quick outlet, and North Carolina bringing it up quickly again. It's their secondary break.
Inside to Meeks, where they've had so much success. He kicks to Jackson. Got Jones in the air. Missed the 15-footer.
Boy, but what a shot fake by Justin Jackson.
Tatum slips. And Meeks has his hands on the ball. He's just looking at officials saying, when are you going to give me the 2 thumbs up for the held ball? They finally do, but the arrow keeps it with Duke. Let's go to Allison Williams.
A couple things for Duke here in the second half. They have to get their guards more involved rebounding. Just 3 total rebounds from all of their guards in that first half, so they really emphasized gang rebounding. And then defensively, they've got to get more pressure on the ball. North Carolina's getting it inside way too easily.
All right, Allison, thank you. Jackson trying to get it inside, but Meeks would have none of it. Boy, Meeks is having a strong game.
Yeah, one of the things with rebounding, though, you got to make a miss first before you can grab a defensive rebound. And the shots have come so close to the basket, there haven't been a lot of opportunities for North Carolina to miss.
Meeks kept it alive, tipped by Jackson, and a foul. Is that Berry who reached in?
Yes.
That is number 3 on Joel Berry. And that's why Roy Williams has that pained expression on his face that you saw moments ago.
And that was one where Joel Berry had to make the decision, do I go for the ball or do I get back in transition? And one of those instances where I may give up a bucket, but I can't get this foul back. What's the smarter play?
Let's see if Jackson tries to drive him. The 3. Got it.
Talk about stopping on a dime.
Jackson's first bucket of the night. Duke back within 7.
Couple of stops, couple of baskets, and this game takes on a completely different tenor.
Berry with 10 to shoot. One-on-one with Kennard. Floater, no. And it is Duke ball.
Frank Jackson is a good driver coming off the ball screen. Not much contact, but just stops on a dime. Joel Berry wanted a little push off. There wasn't much there. But that was just a tremendous individual play by the freshman from Utah.
And Duke is winning the battle on the 3-point line. 6 of 11 compared to 3 of 9.
We expect that Duke's going to win it. They just can't win it by 9 threes like they did in the first game.
Jackson, pull-up jumper, in and out, tip no good. Kennard down with it for the Blue Devils. Kennard creates a little space, but misses the mid-range jumper. Carolina, after shooting over 60% of the first half, they missed their last 5, but you can put that stat to bed.
Got a switch, and Justin Jackson never stops moving. He does a great job of moving without the ball, and that gives him so many opportunities and really occupies a defender and allows his inside guys to do a better job of getting open.
Tatum inside to Jefferson, and a late whistle results in a foul call against Carolina. So it'll be Duke at the line when we come back. They're down by 9, and we get another semifinal coming your way here from Brooklyn. Here come the Seminoles, 2-seed Florida State. And I think even within the program, they would say an up-and-down year for Duke, the consensus number 1 at the beginning of the year, but dealing with injuries and other issues, they have still managed to put up a 25-8 season. Joe Lunardi currently has them as a 3-seed. A very tough ACC schedule. It's not a balanced schedule. They played a ton of road games against the top teams, far more than the other top teams did. And here they are in the semifinals of the ACC, looking at maybe a 3-seed. And if they were to win tonight, maybe they can get up to the 2.
Well, they've got 11 wins against the RPI top 50, 6 of them against the top 25. And I think when you look at all the injuries that Duke has had, Duke has missed 43 games to injury, 50 games if you count Coach K. This is a team that has the profile of a 2-seed. But if you're just going to look at paper and count the paper, then you might say, well, they're a 4-seed. But you can't make a mistake in seeding. That's where the committee has to do a really good job. And I don't think injuries should be taken into account for selection. But I do think they should be taken into account for seeding, how good a team is and how they should be seeded once they have been selected.
Allison Williams with more.
And because of those injuries, Duke is still kind of trying to figure out who they are. That's why these games have been so valuable before they go into the NCAA tournament. Matt Jones told me, he said, we're still trying to find our identity and kind of find our way. We feel like we're a bit of a different team every night. And Coach Krzyzewski said the same thing. He said, crazy as it sounds, I think we're still evolving because of the injuries and the interruptions we've had, but we're getting better, and maybe we can develop more of an identity here in the tournament.
And of course, in an ideal world, most coaches would like to see their team as a finished product at this point, but because of the injuries, Mike Krzyzewski feels his team is still evolving. Right now, Louisville still on the two line, according to Joe Lenardi, as Barry misses inside, but Dr. Lenardi says that the winner of the Arizona-UCLA game that you can see tonight, 11:30 Eastern here on ESPN, the winner of that game, he says, will replace Louisville on the two line. We will find it all out on Sunday.
I'm really surprised Joe Barry missed that layup.
Roy Williams did not like that call at all.
We got Joe Barry again.
Number four on Joe Barry with better than 15 minutes left.
That is a huge call in this game. And a huge play to have Joe Barry with four fouls having to go to the bench for what should be significant minutes. Just caught Frank Jackson on the wrist. Surprising he would even reach for that with three fouls.
And Emile Jefferson called for the foul. Going over the back, number two on Jefferson.
Now just a little push in the back, but you know, I'm one of those. I like the way the game is called for the most part, except rebounding. I think the players should be allowed to go after the ball rebounding. There's going to be some contact. Some of these rebounding fouls are clear fouls. Others are just rebounding. Just rebounding.
So the big story here right now, Joel Berry to the bench with four fouls. Nate Britt, the senior, in at the point for Carolina. Justin Jackson, another three.
With Grayson Allen right there on Justin Jackson, but he pulled that trigger so quickly. You couldn't get a hand up. Now a switch. Well, Allen should have gone straight up with that. Kennedy Meeks left the ground. That could have been three free throws.
You wanted to say he left his feet, but you stopped yourself short.
Your feet go with you. Your feet go with you. You can't leave your feet.
I could feel it.
Justin Jackson is such a confident shooter. Grayson Allen goes over the top, but still had a hand up. And Jackson set his feet. Went up quickly, never took his eyes off the rim.
A much improved shooter over his first 2 years in Chapel Hill, and says he spent hour upon hour upon hour working on shooting drills over the summer. Meeks down with a loose ball.
And he may very well set a record for three-point field goals made in a single season. That record has been standing for quite some time. Shimon Williams set the record in 1997. It's 98?
I believe 95.
95.
Yeah. And he's closing in on it. And Meeks is closing in on a very, very big night. He's up to 19 now to go with 10 rebounds.
North Carolina shoes are wearing out the paint.
Tatum!
Jason Tatum is such a great player. It is ridiculous how talented he is. You give him a straight line to the basket. He had a big dunk in the game at Cameron, a one-hander over Kennedy Meeks. That was a two-hander over everybody in the lane. That's a big-time play by a big-time player.
It's with Selection Sunday, 7 o'clock Eastern Time on ESPN, a bracketology presented by Allstate. Reese, J. Will, J. Bill, Seth Greenberg, Dickie V, and a host of our College Hoop experts with complete breakdowns of each region. Sports Center with Scott Van Pelt starts it all off at 5:15 with a reveal of the NCAA men's field of 68 as the teams are announced. Obviously, these two teams are both entrenched with a very good seed. North Carolina, in all likelihood, regardless of what happens here tonight and or possibly tomorrow, looks like a one seed, and Duke remains to be seen. Two, three, see what happens to them depending on what happens over the next couple of days.
With Joel Berry on the bench with four fouls, he picked up his fourth with about 15 minutes to go in regulation. Nate Britt becomes a really important player for North Carolina to come in and run the point. Theo Pinson also can be a primary handler.
Let's check in again with Allison.
Well, Roy Williams, of course, not happy with the fouls his team has picked up, but he's also not happy with how they're responding after those fouls. He said, you don't need to be throwing your hands up and complaining. That's not going to help us. What you need to do is you need to go out there, play defense, no more excuses, do your job.
They've committed 16 fouls to 10 committed by Duke. And Barry on the bench with four.
Good fake.
Allen the kick to Tatum for a wide open three. Long rebound down to Grayson Allen.
Wow.
And Kennard knocks one down and has a chance for a four-point play.
Boy, what a play by Grayson Allen. It looked like Allen after that loose ball, he might shoot the three, but passed it to Luke Kennard in the corner. And how quick was that from the catch to the release? I thought Allen was going to pull the trigger on this one. Boy, that is as quick a catch and shoot as you are going to see. What a big play.
And 4 points for Kennard. Terrific play by Allen. Duke back within seven.
Carolina's got to go inside. Duke has been a jump shooting team, but Carolina's got to be the team that goes to the paint.
Giles with a block. Bradley brings it down, but a foul call going against Duke.
Tony Bradley took that ball up and got it blocked right in his hands. Then the ball was loose when the whistle was blown.
It's on Jefferson.
Really good block there. I don't know where the foul was.
Maybe a little push to nudge Bradley out of bounds as he was going after the loose ball.
Very little. That's what I'm talking about. Let the guys rebound.
Back door to Hicks.
Oh, what a great play. Everybody goes with a cutter, leaves the screener wide open.
What's that? Eight assists now for Pinson.
Magic Johnson.
Allen uses the screen and misses a good look, and here come the heels.
Nice block out by Pinson.
Off the rim, down to Tatum. A bigger lineup here for Duke. Tatum's at the three as he feeds Allen. They've got Tatum, Jefferson, and Giles all in the game at the same time. You don't see that alignment a lot for the Blue Devils.
Well, North Carolina has some opportunities to finish. Both defenders, Kennard and Jason Tatum, go with the cutter. And that left the screener, Isaiah Hicks, wide open. Not enough pressure on the ball to discourage that pass. And North Carolina, just about every basket they have is coming off an assist.
Carolina's already committed six fouls here in the second half. So the next foul would put Duke into the bonus. Duke's got some very good free throw shooters on their team, and they're going to be at the line a lot, it looks like.
Well, if you get in the bonus this early, that just invites Duke to attack off the dribble and puts North Carolina in a position to foul even more.
You get the feeling if we could read Roy Williams' mind right now, he might be saying, man, I'm not comfortable with the lead where it is. We should be up more given the way the game has been played, but it's only seven.
I think you could read any coach's mind, and they're never comfortable with the lead they have.
Stolen away.
What a pass.
Tatum passed up the three. Allen won't, and knocks it down. Fifth three of the game for Grayson Allen, and Duke's on an 11-2 run.
Carolina, a different team without Joel Berry on the floor.
He sat down with four fouls at the 15:04 mark. It was an 8-point lead then for Carolina. It's four now.
I don't know why Justin Jackson wants to take jump shots when getting the ball inside will open up more things, not only for the big guys, but for the perimeter players.
Kennard to a slashing Jackson, who makes it a 2-point game.
Duke's drives are opening up opportunities, in part because North Carolina's foul trouble.
Timeout, Carolina. Momentum, Duke.
Grayson Allen has been a shooter in this game, but he has also been a playmaking passer. Catching the ball in the corner, knocking down the three-point shot. He's hit at least five of those things. He's been on fire, but also passing very effectively.
It's an important question you ask, but one...
At 18, six different winners the last 6 years. With North Carolina the champion last year, but the last team to win the ACC tournament and the NCAA championship was Duke back in 2010. In ACC tournament play, Duke leads over Carolina 12-8 in head-to-head matchups. The last time they met was 2011 in the championship game, won by Duke. Duke has won the last five over Carolina in the ACC tournament. Carolina hasn't beaten Duke in this tournament since 1998.
North Carolina running a set to try to get the ball to Justin Jackson if they couldn't get it inside. And then the Tar Heels come up with another offensive rebound. They haven't gotten offensive rebounds for stick backs, but they've provided some extra possessions. 12 offensive rebounds for North Carolina. Even though Duke's won the second chance point battle. But before the game, Dan, we talked about the lines for Duke. The three-point line and the free throw line. Duke is plus 12. From the three-point line, they're plus 10 from the free throw line. That's why they are just one bucket down in this game, even though North Carolina has dominated the paint. Plus 24 points for the Tar Heels in the lane.
So it's playing out exactly according to the script. It's just a question of will it be Carolina's inside dominance or Duke's dominance at the lines that will emerge victorious. And if you weren't with us for the last few minutes, first of all, what were you thinking? And second of all, Joel Berry, big story. On the bench, four fouls, went out at the 15:04 mark. And Carolina actually extended the lead for a little while after Berry went to the bench. Got it from 8 up to 13, but now it's down to 2 with a lot of time yet. Do you have a feeling when Roy Williams might say, I got to get Berry back in the game?
Well, if they go down in this game, you might have to put him back in. But, I mean, it might be at the 8-minute mark or under 8. And right now, Roy Williams wearing his team out for some of the mental mistakes that they've made during this game. And, you know, Luke Kennard just had a, I don't know if you want to call it a mismatch, but a favorable matchup with Brandon Robinson guarding him. He decided to drive it. And Isaiah Hicks was guarding Jason Tatum, a matchup that Duke can go after. Every common foul, Duke is shooting free throws the remainder of the way.
In the bonus with 10:21 to go. And it's tied at 63. Duke has never led in this game. As Kennard is called for the foul.
Duke trying to use Emil Jefferson to trap. He's a trapping big guy, so whether it's in the backcourt after the ball's inbounded or just over half court, you just don't want to foul doing it.
Because Jefferson's got three. Pinson makes his way to the scorer's table for Carolina. Britt at the point right now for the Heels. Britt sneaks inside, gets it off, and hits.
Well, it's so difficult for Emil Jefferson to be able to get over there to try to block that shot or stop the drive when he has to guard Tony Bradley, who's really posting up strong.
A lot of contact between Brandon Robinson and Jason Tatum. Allen off balance, no. And there's the fourth foul on Emil Jefferson.
He was wedged in between Robinson and Hicks. Hicks had inside position. And the clear path to that rebound. And Emil Jefferson has been playing so hard. Just discarded. No, it wasn't Robinson, it was Nate Britt. He just discarded Nate Britt. But that's kind of what I've just been talking about, Dan. Like, look, is that a foul? Yes. But it's also part of rebounding.
So Jefferson trying to turn the page from his feeling about the foul call and turn into a cheerleader on the bench as Harry Giles takes his place.
North Carolina needs to go inside.
The Let's Go Duke chant that was dominating moments ago now being drowned out a little bit by the Tar Heels chant as Meeks is bumped. Are they going to count it? Yes, they are.
No,
they're
not. It's on the floor. It's on the floor.
You are correct, sir. My mistake. Allen called for the foul.
Really good dive by Kennedy Meeks. Oftentimes that's Isaiah Hicks that dives after the double team. But when you've got one guy in the low post, the other big guy up top, and North Carolina is used to seeing those post-to-post doubles. They come often when they play Virginia. And the most success that North Carolina has is with the opposite big guy diving to the rim. Duke right now with North Carolina having some foul trouble. Duke needs to drive the ball.
Kennard dumps it off for Giles. Allen the kick to Jackson. First lead of the night for the Blue Devils.
That shot was made by the penetration by Grayson Allen. It's a big time play.
Duke is 9 of 16 from three-point range.
Oh, they're trading 3 for Carolina's 2.
Meeks blocked. And it's going to be a travel called on Hicks.
Duke starting to pack the paint and forcing North Carolina to consider shooting over the top. But with North Carolina's foul difficulties, and Duke has to continue to drive it. You drive it, then you can kick it, drive it again.
Justin Jackson returns for Carolina. Joel Berry remains on the bench. Since Carolina had its biggest lead of the night at 13, Duke's on an 18-4 run. Make it 20. And for the third game in a row, Kennard, a quiet first half, a big second half.
You're not going to hold him down all game long. But Joel Berry continues to sit on the bench with 4 fouls, and North Carolina floundering offensively without him.
Pinson the tip. Ball's loose. And it belongs to the Tar Heels.
Duke, after trailing most of this game when North Carolina was dominating the paint, now Duke is getting the ball into the paint and kicking it out to open three-point shooters. Duke is starting to dominate the lines, the three-point line and the free throw line. Blue Devils lead. Then Nate Britt comes off of a corner three-point shooter, Frank Jackson. You cannot leave corner three-point shooters. Make Duke take tough twos. And the lines, we talked about the three-point line, the free throw line. Duke is plus 15 from the three-point line. They are 9 of 16. And they are plus 12 from the free throw line. 19 of 21 to North Carolina, 7 of 9.
It's not who leads most, it's who leads last. Duke didn't lead a whole lot against Louisville in the quarterfinal yesterday. Came back from a 12-point second half deficit to win. They were down as many as 13 to Carolina in the second half here tonight. Berry remains on the bench for the Heels out of the timeout. Hicks is fouled.
A terrific job by Justin Jackson after setting a screen. He was the low man on the stagger. He came off of Isaiah Hicks on the other end and curled it. And when there was a step up, he just dumped it right down to Hicks.
So, Jay, now 4 on Tatum. Remember, Jefferson is sitting on the bench with 4. Matt Jones, who hasn't played a whole lot tonight, comes to the scorer's table, presumably to take out Tatum. They lose a real offensive weapon, and they get pretty small as well.
Well, they'll lose an offensive weapon for a few minutes, but North Carolina's lost their point guard for the better part of the last 8 or 9 minutes. And who knows how much longer Roy Williams is going to keep him over there, but that fourth foul by Joel Berry totally changed this game.
So 3 critically important players, 1 for Carolina, 2 for Duke, on the bench right now with 4 fouls as Hicks makes them both to make it a 1-point game.
And North Carolina needs to continue to go inside because Duke is going to continue to drive it. They're going to look for the mismatch.
Allen to Kennard. Kennard the kick. Jackson's hit a couple from there. Can't get it off.
Good job by Kennedy Meeks to get out there on Frank Jackson.
Allen. Ball's loose. Belongs to Carolina. They can reclaim the lead.
Great defense. They didn't come off three-point shooters. They made Duke take the tough two. Good save.
Hinson off to Britt. Open for three. Hinson with an offensive rebound, and now it's down to Duke. Good hands by Britt to deflect it out of bounds.
Nate Britt just saved an open three because Grayson Allen was going to catch that and either shoot it or shot fake and drive. North Carolina was in scramble mode back in transition, and that deflection saved a bucket.
Boy, all kinds of traffic on the inbounds play, and it's Britt called for the foul.
Take a look at Nate Britt, first denying the pass and then reaching in. I didn't see that. It's just two guys going after the ball.
And it puts an 84% free throw shooter at the line. In this tournament, Jay, in the first half of the three games, Luke Kennard has 14 points. In the second half of the three games, he has 46 points.
See, what you just need to do is before the game, just give him orange slices and some Gatorade and make him think it's halftime.
Yep. Duke by three, winner into the championship game. Britt, a chance to tie it.
Heck of a play by Nate Britt. He had Matt Jones on his hip. Looked like Jones was going to commit the foul and actually did. They just didn't call it. Got all the way to the rim, and Harry Giles has to get there earlier to be able to block that shot. He was waiting to time it out. He needed to get over there and put his body in front of Nate Britt and then go up. Anytime you allow the shooter to get into your body as a shot blocker, it's pretty much all over.
And Britt, of course, good with both hands. He shoots his jumpers right-handed. Used to shoot him lefty. You saw him just shoot a free throw left-handed. The drive was left-handed. He's tied it at 70. Round three, living up to the hype. Jackson soft off the window. Duke back on top.
Got it up off the glass before the North Carolina big guys could time it out to block the shot. What a game.
All three have been terrific this year. Duke by eight at Cameron, Carolina by seven in Chapel Hill.
That's a terrible call right there. Absolutely terrible.
That Jackson called for the offensive foul.
That was not an offensive foul. That is not an offensive foul. No way. That's just basketball.
So we're inside 6 minutes to go.
If the offensive player pushes off with the arm, fine.
Kennard got it.
What a player. Devastating from the three-point line.
Now a rejection. Giles from Allen. A 20-point swing here in the second half from 13 down to up seven for the Blue Devils.
Duke just out fighting North Carolina, and Joel Berry about to come in. You wonder if he can swing this back after spending so much time on the bench, almost 10 minutes.
And again, Bears repeating, third game in as many nights for Duke. They did not get the double bye.
They called an offensive foul there, too?
I believe they did.
Holy cow.
It is. Fouls on Allen, his third.
What a terrific pass. Grayson Allen with his drives is able to find open teammates, and just a fabulous pass in transition to Harry Giles.
Berry is back in. Jay Berry sat just over 10 minutes after picking up the fourth foul. 10 minutes and 6 seconds, and Duke outscored Carolina 29-14 while he was out.
just a valuable piece for North Carolina, not just because of his leadership and his speed, but because he can score.
Jackson from the baseline, no. Giles down with a rebound, giving them some good minutes with Jefferson and Tatum on the bench.
Really nice play there by Matt Jones.
Kennard calls for the ball screen.
Just spreading North Carolina out and attacking off the dribble. Got the walk there. Well, let's take a look back at that offensive foul on Grayson Allen. I didn't think that was even close to a foul, but we've got two really bad offensive foul calls in a row. So both teams are even. You got to have some contact in basketball. Maybe that was a makeup call. That's the only explanation for these two horrendous offensive foul calls, one on North Carolina, one on Duke.
Let's see if Joel Berry can right the ship for Carolina. Came in about a minute ago. As we mentioned, he missed over 10 minutes this half after picking up his fourth foul. And North Carolina saw its lead evaporate during that time. Britt's back in as well. Couldn't get it up over the rim. Got it back. Olsen!
Oh. Whoa! I think he's feeling better after his injury.
Alert pass, too, by Britt.
Wow.
Round three is kind of fun. Doesn't happen often. First time since 2011. Just the second time in the last 14 years. North Carolina and Duke have met in the ACC tournament. Kind of game you don't want to end. 3:36 to go. Blue Devils by five.
Who says it has to end?
Lock in, and the intensity picks up as soon as the game begins. These arch rivals meeting for the third time in about a month, for the second time in less than a week. North Carolina leading most of the night, but a furious second half comeback by the Duke Blue Devils, and they've got a 5-point lead with 3:36 to go. Again, they trailed most of the day against Louisville yesterday, came back from 12 down to win it. They were down 13 to Carolina earlier here in the second half, but with Joel Berry on the bench with four fouls. For better than 10 minutes, he was out, and Duke outscored Carolina 29-14 with Berry sitting on the bench. Jefferson, Tatum each with four, both back into the game now for the Blue Devils.
And a mismatch inside with Britt guarding Jefferson.
And Jefferson will take advantage.
And just beat the 30-second clock. Jefferson playing with four fouls. Jason Tatum playing with four fouls for Duke. We've got some great minutes from Harry Giles in this one.
Berry from the corner. Desperately needed shot. Won't go down. Out of bounds, though. It stays with the heels. Florida State and Notre Dame waiting in the wings. Still to come in the second semifinal tonight here on ESPN. The championship game tomorrow night, 9 Eastern, here on ESPN. On the inbounds, Pinson rejected. Jefferson is fired up.
This is one hard team to guard with Allen, Jackson, Tatum, and Kennard on the floor. That is a spread floor.
Nice pass. Jackson finds Tatum underneath.
They are just spreading out this North Carolina defense and really able to attack in space. And this was the team that you expected earlier in the season from Duke had they been healthy. And if you can have these four right there playing together and playing well at the same time, what team has four defenders that are going to be able to guard those four at any given time? None that I can think of.
Jefferson just fouled out of the game, so Giles back in. Back to your point about the Duke offense, Tatum and Kennard have both scored 20 or more points in all three games here in the ACC tournament.
Yeah, it's ridiculous how good they are. They're so versatile.
Or Champ Week action over in the Big 12 in Kansas City. Iowa State defeated TCU to advance onto the championship game. They'll play the winner of Kansas State and West Virginia. That game currently going on ESPN2. The championship game, 6 o'clock tomorrow night here on ESPN. ACC championship, 9 o'clock tomorrow night. And then the Pac-12 championship right after the championship here at about 11 o'clock Eastern time. What a great night for basketball fans tomorrow.
North Carolina coming with full court pressure. The immediate trap and foul. And you're just taking 80% free throw shooters and allowing them to walk 70 feet to the free throw line.
Allen, Kennard, and Tatum are all better than 80% free throw shooters on the season. You know, a lot of teams make comebacks. This one really, really impressive. Down 13 in the second half, playing their third game in as many nights, second game in as many nights for Carolina. So not as worn down, you would think. The Heels also a deeper team. But Duke with an incredibly impressive second half for the second game in a row.
Well, it just shows you the value of having four guys that can knock down perimeter shots. You know, the three-point shot is an asymmetrical threat. It's one thing to space the floor. A lot of teams can space the floor. Duke can stretch the defense. You have to go out there and guard them, and that opens up a lot of drives.
Meeks comes up with it. Jackson will try again.
Looks like they got a Duke foul.
Giles, perhaps.
There's the offensive board strength of North Carolina. And oftentimes when you get an offensive rebound, kick it out for an open three like Justin Jackson just had, you know, that can be a really, really big play. North Carolina with inside position. Unless they called the bump really early on, there wasn't much there either. That's the one area where, you know, rebounding is not a freedom of movement issue. They got to let these guys rebound.
Britt on his way back in. Meeks will sit.
And Kennedy Meeks comes out primarily. This is a defense switch to get a little more quickness to press. Pitts an 80% free throw shooter, so you have to expect him to make it. Then you put Pinson on the ball and try to get a steal here.
They get it in just in time. Handling the pressure and eventually the foul to send Tatum, an 87% free throw shooter, to the line. Number 4 on Britt.
With this lineup, you can see how Duke will be so difficult to defend against in the NCAA tournament. And even though Duke not as deep as some other teams, in the tournament you get a day's rest from either Thursday, Saturday, or Friday, Sunday, and then you get a week off before your next four-team tournament. Because that's all the NCAA tournament is. It's really a collection of four-team tournaments in your sub-bracket.
As Jay talked about at the top of the show, Duke had to do well from the three-point line and the free-throw line to win the game. They have excelled at both, and even though they're not that deep at 6-7, because Allen is coming off the bench right now. 6-7 are giving them a lot more than they were just a week or two ago, really. Allen and Giles. Giles has become a bigger part of things for Duke. And Grayson Allen has become a much bigger part of things over the last couple of days.
Allen's really the key. Grayson Allen has not played well since his 25-point game against North Carolina in Cameron Indoor Stadium, where he had 7 threes, if I remember correctly. He really struggled, shot about 28-29% from the field since then, and that included the 18-point game he had yesterday against Louisville. But in this game, he's been spectacular. Not just knocking shots down, but aggressively driving it, finding open teammates.
Allen's made 5 threes. He's also got 5 assists in this game, to your point.
Yeah, a true difference maker coming off the bench. You have the defense of Matt Jones in the starting lineup, although Jones has had difficulty finding open shots and making open shots when Allen comes off the bench firing. This is one potent offensive basketball team.
Berry with a tough finish and a timeout taken by Roy Williams. A 9-point lead for Duke with a minute 26 to go. Try to advance onto the championship game tomorrow night.
Walk.
Meeks returns for North Carolina. Giles back in for Duke.
Number of offense defense switches. Harry Giles can protect the rim and rebound. And North Carolina's put in more of an offensive minded lineup.
Frank Jackson
faked it. He faked it.
We've got a foul against Duke, and obviously with the benefit of replay, we'll get another look at what, if any, contact there was between Justin Jackson and Frank Jackson.
That looked like he faked it. I hope I'm wrong there.
And they're going to send the players up.
No, he got
to
a little bit. He took a little bit of an elbow.
They're going to look
at early on. It was early on, so the reaction was late. It looked like he faked it. I'm glad I am wrong there.
They're going to look at it on the monitor.
It was very early, and then the reaction looked late. So I'm glad I was wrong.
So there is a personal foul call that went, I believe, on Kennard. Later on in the play as Justin Jackson got to the basket, but is that anything? And I don't think they'll call that a flagrant one.
You know, it was similar. I mean, remember the game at Duke, they called, at North Carolina, they called something like that on Grayson Allen. It was after the foul was committed by Brandon Robinson, and they called that it was the equivalent of a flagrant. They called it a dead ball contact technical because it came after the foul. This one was before the foul or before the stoppage in play. And you know, I thought the one on Allen shouldn't have been called. I feel the same way about this one. But it's odd that, you know, like one, so this is being called a basketball play, and it's just odd that they're called so different. Obviously, different crews in a different game.
So it doesn't look like they're calling anything on it based on the way things are going out here. So the personal call was on Kennard that sends Justin Jackson to the line. Of course, it would have been a huge call had they called a flagrant one. Duke would have gotten, got a couple of free throws and the ball. So they're going to get the ball here as Jackson makes one out of two, and it's still an 8-point deficit with only a minute 21 to go.
Yeah, it seems like this is just too big of a deficit for North Carolina to be able to overcome, especially as well as Duke shoots free throws. And what a phenomenal second half by Duke. Just the way they attacked. Not just attacking matchups, but attacking off the dribble and knocking down open threes. Just having these four outstanding perimeter players, you know, Frank Jackson, Grayson Allen, Luke Kennard, Jason Tatum, having them on the floor at the same time. You've got to guard all 50 feet side to side on the floor. But the foul is on Kennedy Meeks going over the back.
Bill Covington Jr., one of the officials, coming over and telling us they're checking to see if time came off the clock when the foul happened, and they've taken 1 second off. So they've moved it from 121 down to 120.
Yeah, it was after the missed free throw. But Harry Giles gave really good minutes to Duke in this game.
Still to come, our second semifinal here from Brooklyn. The Seminoles are loosening up and waiting for their opportunity to head out on the court and take on Notre Dame. These two split two games during the regular season. The winner will advance to the championship game tomorrow night.
To see how many Seminoles just did their slides right past the camera?
All of them are going to play.
That's right.
Leonard Hamilton has a lot of bodies, and he puts them all in there. He's liable to use 12 different guys for significant minutes. Giles with a couple of big free throws and a big round of applause as he goes to the bench.
This may be his best game. I mean, I know he had a double-double earlier in the season against Georgia Tech at Duke, but I think this is Harry Giles' best game. A 2-3 zone right now for Duke. Make North Carolina try to score over the top, take some time off the clock.
Jackson way short. Ball to Kennard. Duke fans getting louder and louder with each passing possession right now. From down 13 at 61-48 to up 10. And on their way to the championship game at Sherwood Seam tomorrow night.
Boy, it looked, Duke gave up almost 50 in the first half. And Duke is going to wind up with over 90 in this one. That's a powerful offensive basketball team because of the ability to knock down three-point shots and the ability to drive it.
Remember when Roy Williams talked to Allison Williams coming after the beginning of the second half, he said, you know, we committed a few too many fouls. We let him knock down some shots at the end of the half. We got to stop fouling. We can't put them on the line. And Roy Williams' worst fears came true in the second half.
Well, Duke healthy and North Carolina, both these teams are Final Four good. We could see this one again in Phoenix. That would not be a surprise.
Round four.
Hey, they used to play four of these.
Yep.
A lot back in the days of the Big Four. There used to be a tournament early in the season, Duke, North Carolina, Wake Forest, and NC State. And they would play, you could be 0-2 after the Big Four. Mm-hmm. And then you'd play your two times in conference play back when the league was eight teams, and then play again in the ACC tournament.
Hicks.
Isaiah Hicks.
And a timeout taken by Carolina.
Before the game started, we talked about the lines. And for Duke to win this game, they had to dominate the three-point line and also the free throw line. And it was mission accomplished in that regard. Grayson Allen came into the game off the bench firing. He hit four threes in the first half. In the second half, Luke Kennard, Frank Jackson, Jason Tatum, all getting into the act and knocking down threes against this North Carolina defense. That was one of the bigger ones there. And a couple of corner threes. This is all in one game. This is not a highlight package from a week. And in addition to the three-point line, Duke was driving it, getting to the free throw line. What a difference. 10 threes to North Carolina's four. Not quite as pronounced a difference in the first game where Duke hit 13 to North Carolina's four. But a bigger difference in the free throw line in this game than the first one in Duke's favor.
Time now for tonight's Player of the Game brought to you by Jersey Mike Subs. And it is Jason Tatum who's having a magnificent ACC tournament. 24 points and 7 rebounds in this one. He had 20 points against Clemson in the second round. And he had 25 points against Louisville in the quarterfinals. So he has now scored 69 points in three games against really good competition here in this tournament.
You know the funny part about Jason Tatum? He's going to get better.
Yep.
He is going to get better.
And he's going to hear his name called awfully early in the draft. Just an outstanding talent, one of a number of tremendously gifted freshmen on the collegiate level. We'll see another one, Jonathan Isaac, for the Seminoles in the second game tonight as Florida State takes on Notre Dame.
We're about to see another one step to the free throw line, Frank Jackson. In his last four games, Frank Jackson coming into this one was averaging 18 points per game. He had hit 10 of 16 from three and then came into this one and had another outstanding game, played big minutes. You know, on switches, he was caught on big guys, fought them.
No team has ever won four games in 4 days to win the ACC tournament. Duke trying to become the first. We were talking before the game. remember Kemba Walker and UConn back in the 2011 in the Big East. They won five games in 5 days and went on to win the national championship that year.
I think Louisville did it too and won four games in the Big East tournament. Yes. One in 2012. Yep. That's a tough task, especially against, I think it, from this bracket that Duke and Carolina were in, it's harder to win the ACC championship than it is to get to a Final Four. I mean, you got to beat a higher caliber of team in order to win this championship than you would have to beat to get to a Final Four. It's remarkable.
If you have to go through Louisville, North Carolina, and then either Notre Dame or Florida State on consecutive days, that's crazy. And Roy Williams is waving the white flag.
That is quite a win for Duke against the North Carolina team. I mean, both these teams, with Duke healthy now and in this rhythm, both these teams are capable of reaching Phoenix and winning this thing. And you can see now why people were so excited about the possibilities for Duke before the season. You know, if you had a healthy Harry Giles for an entire year, a healthy Marquise Bolden, a healthy Jason Tatum, and this team from Jump Street was able to get acquainted with one another from October on. But the way they are starting to come together and, as they say, find an identity, kind of scary what this team could accomplish in the NCAA tournament.
Stillman Whites will knock down a three for Carolina. Duke has put up 51 points here in the second half. They go from 13 down midway through the second half to a 10-point win. A heck of a win for the Duke Blue Devils as they move on to the championship game tomorrow night against the winner of our next semifinal between Florida State and Notre Dame. Carolina perhaps still locked on the one seed given the very strong year that they've had. And again, Duke will try to become the first team to win four games in 4 days to win the ACC tournament. They'll head back to the hotel, get some rest, and watch the second game, no doubt, as the Seminoles take on the Irish in what should be another quality basketball game here in Brooklyn. Jason Tatum leading the way for Duke with 24. Luke Kennard had 20, 15 of them in the second half. Grayson Allen knocked down five threes. And Duke wins 93-83 over North Carolina in the third matchup of the season between these two great programs. Allison Williams is with Mike Krzyzewski.
Coach K, you trailed by as much as 13. What sparked that 20-4 run?
You know, our kids have guts. And Grayson's back to being a great player. And Luke just shook off. He didn't score a point. And then all of a sudden, we got a loose ball here. Grayson did. And he hit Luke, and we got a four-point play. And our kids have guts, and we beat a great team, you know. And I don't know we had the energy. You know, hopefully we have something for tomorrow night. But my guys are playing lights out. I mean, with great courage, you know, to come back like that against them after two games, it's crazy.
Yeah, that's what I want to ask you about, though, is the energy. You'll have to win your fourth game in 4 days to get the championship you came for. How much is in the tank?
Well, they'd rather do that than practice. So, you know, it's an honor to win any game in this tournament and to be able to play for a tournament championship, you know, four straight days. I'm not sure anybody's won it that way. So, yeah, maybe we could be the first one. We're going to try to be the first one to do that.
Mike, thank you so much. We'll see you tomorrow.
What a win for the Duke Blue Devils. On to the final tomorrow night against the winner of Florida State and Notre Dame, and we'll have that second semifinal coming your way about 20 minutes from now from Brooklyn. Should be fun. 93-83 Duke.